Yeah, in about 30 seconds.
No.
That would be good.
Good evening. We'll call the meeting to order. Welcome everyone here this evening. It's nice to see some faces out there. Hope you enjoy the meeting. We'll get right to work. The first item on the agenda is the Pledge of Allegiance. Is Jason Hodge in the crowd?
Jacob,
I'm sorry. It says Jason. Jacob, I'm sorry, sir. I got the last name right and the first name wrong. Please come. Lisa? If you would, sir, please, when she gets us up, lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Jacob, if you'll sit right here, I'll get to you in just a minute. You sit on the front row. The first item then is the approval of the agenda.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Made and second. All in favor? Okay. Jacob led us in the Pledge of Allegiance. His name again is Jacob Hodge. And if you would please stand, I want to tell them a little bit about you, sir. Jacob is a fifth grader at Wakeland Elementary School who exemplifies Bulldog pride. He is responsible, he follows the rules, and shows respect for himself and others. He is a student council member, he participates in the running club, and he raises and lowers the flag each day for the school. The teachers at Wakeland state that Jacob is a model student. He is diligent about completing and turning in assignments. He supports his classmates when they are struggling, and he is a class helper for his teachers. Wakeland is very proud of Jacob and all of his accomplishments. His commitment to academic excellence is inspiring, and we can't wait to hear about all of the great things he's going to do in middle school next year. So, Jacob, thank you very much. We're glad to have you here this evening, and I would offer a round of applause. Thank you, sir. You want to say something? You don't have to. It's up to you. Okay. All right. We also have a teacher that we're recognizing this month from Wakeland Elementary School. And I'll just read the letter that came from Angela Cooper, the principal at Wakeland Elementary. It is indeed an honor to write this essay on behalf of Ms. Kimberly Messina. Ms. Messina has been an educator for 12 years. We have been privileged to have her as a pre-K teacher at Wakeland for 3 years. She serves as a beacon of light and joy for her students daily. She states that her greatest influence for becoming a teacher is an unrelenting love for children. Since I have been at Wakeland Elementary School, I have had many opportunities to witness Ms. Messina's professionalism and dedication. She establishes high standards for all of her students and assists them in reaching their goals. She provides support and guidance for those students who experience difficulty. Her lessons reach everyone in the class, especially those who may be academically challenged. She is flexible and understands the needs of preschoolers, special needs students, and those who are at risk. Ms. Messina's expectations for her students are clearly communicated daily. She understands how preschool students learn and accommodate their various styles. She plans thoroughly and executes her plans carefully. She exhibits true fairness and firmness in her interactions with all students. Ms. Messina is an extraordinary educator and one who will go the extra mile to help any child in need. Ms. Messina's nurturing attitude, professional manner, and her commitment to students are the keys to her success as a teacher. She is continually learning so she can provide her students with new adventures daily. Every day, Ms. Messina's students leave her classroom with something important. The desire to achieve. So please, Ms. Messina, if we could recognize you.
Thank you.
We're proud of both of you, and we appreciate you coming and joining us this evening, and wish you well. Continued success. Okay, the next item is public comment period. We have two people that have signed up. They will be allowed 3 minutes each, and I will ask that you come to the podium and identify yourself. Sherry Hayes.
Mayor Matheny. She is with the budget.
Both of them are?
Yes.
You gave me two sheets.
She came in after I gave you the sheet, so that's the second sheet.
Well, that would do it. My mistake. We have some public comment later, and we normally have a public comment period for 3 minutes. And to explain to you, I was given two sheets. I thought one was for the first and one was for later. So, having said that, that page is finished, and we'll move on to the next page. So, how about that? Budget comments, which is what these lists are for. Each person or group will have 5 minutes to speak during this section. And
consent agenda.
We didn't adopt the consent? I'm really messed up tonight, folks. We need to adopt the consent agenda.
Motion to adopt consent agenda.
Second.
All in favor? All right, maybe I can get my head screwed on straight here. Sorry about that. Okay, so now we're down to budget comments. Community budget updates. Those nonprofits who receive funds will give an update on their programs. And then also, if they're requesting more, they can bind, you know, their comments into how they used any monies that they received last year and their request for upcoming. So I'll start off with Carrie Christensen with Interact, I believe.
Hi, good evening. I'm going to just switch and move these around. I think I have to pass these around. Good evening. I'm Carrie Christensen. I'm Associate Executive Director of Interact, and I appreciate you having us come tonight so that you can hear a little bit more about what we have done over the past year. I want to first just thank you for your past support. You supported us last year, and we greatly appreciate that support, so thank you for that. We have requested $1,000 again for this year. Interact is the only provider of domestic and sexual violence services in Wake County. We have, and I'm gonna kind of talk about these services as I kind of broke down the cost based on the number of Zebulon residents that we assisted. And we may not have captured all Zebulon residents because we track folks by zip code. So when somebody calls or comes in and they decide to not give us that zip code, we may not know that they're where they're from. So we estimate that we've served more folks from Zebulon than what our numbers show, but these are the ones that we know that we have served. So shelter bed nights, you all will see that for your $1,000 investment that the town of Zebulon residents who need us are receiving a lot of services. So we have a 48 bed shelter. I'm gonna end my presentation with a story about one of the Zebulon residents, and so I'm gonna just kind of talk through pieces of the services that she and her family used while they were with us. So we provide anything that families need. Our average stay now is up to about 90 days. We know that housing in Wake County is not easy to find, even when you have two income families. So for somebody who's starting completely over, it's difficult to find housing and get a job and all the things that you need in that 90-day period. So we assist with that. We're providing support groups and counseling for the adults and the children who are in the shelter, and also in the community. We have community groups. At any given time, we have about 14 groups going on throughout our 8-week group cycles. We are the first community-based forensic examination center in Wake County. So anybody who is raped or sexually assaulted and needs a rape kit can come directly to Interact, to our office, and they do not have to go to the hospital and wait in the busy emergency department. We will assist them right there. We have a full-time forensic examination nurse on staff, and we contract out with about 10 others right now. We also have follow-up services for rape crisis for victims of of sexual assault, so we follow up with anybody. We also provide, we have volunteers that go out into the community and respond to any hospital or the Solace Center, and we are with any victim of rape or sexual assault through that examination, and then we work with law enforcement through follow-up, and we have support groups for them as well. We just started a new program last year. I think when I came last year, we were just getting ready to launch it. So we now have e-filing. It's fully up and running. So someone can come into Interact's office and receive that first initial ex parte or protective order without ever leaving our office. So they no longer have to go to court to get that order. We video conference right from our office with the clerk and the judge, and they leave with that protective order in hand. So when they come back home to Zebulon, they can go right to the police department, and the police department may already be hooked in to that system, so they could even pull it up and see that before they even get back here. So it's an electronic way. It's much faster and much safer for the victim. And when you're in court, children aren't allowed. So we have a whole play area for children, and we have volunteers that play with the kids while the mom is getting the protective order. So we're really proud about that service and happy to have it. I talked about the support groups. The other new thing that we have just implemented, so we have always had a co-location model, and I think I extended an invitation last year for you all to come visit. I would like to extend that again so that you can come and see where we work and how we work. We have a co-location model, so we have legal aid right in our building. We have Raleigh Police Department there. Their entire domestic violence unit is there. We have just added an assistant from the district attorney's office who comes twice a week to our office. So anybody who needs to speak to the district attorney about an upcoming criminal case, she's right there. They can see her without ever leaving our office. I talked about e-filing. We also have Karen. They provide services for folks who are from Southeast Asia, so they're in our building as well. So we have a lot of services right under our roof where when a victim comes to us, they don't have to leave our building and go somewhere else for service. I just gave you a little breakdown there about kind of the demographics of the folks that we serve, and then you'll see that we also have donors and volunteers, and those are volunteers who work closely with us, who come in and help us provide support groups for the kids, may co-facilitate for the adult groups. We have volunteers that work in the shelter. We have all kinds of special programming that we do.
Ma'am, you're out of time. If you could wrap it up, please.
Yes. So I'll just end quickly with the story of Shirley, who worked with us for a year and utilized all the services that I talked about. She is now has moved back to Zebulon after a period of being with us and helping her find a job and all the services that she needed for the kids to go back to daycare, and is a tax-paying, productive member of your community again. And so that's what we're here to do at Interact, and we appreciate your support.
Thank you. Shannon White, Eastwick Education Foundation.
Good evening. My name is Shannon White. I'm with Eastwick Education Foundation. I just wanted to thank you for the opportunity for us to speak tonight. I wanted to thank you for your past support of the foundation with your donations. Our mission at Eastwick Education Foundation is for every child to enter school healthy and ready to learn. Due to certain family situations, for some families, that's not something that's easy for them to do. Where private preschool for you and me might be easy, it's not for every family. Another thing that some parents don't see is the importance and how critical it is those early years of learning for kids to learn things like shapes and colors. So that's where we come in. Our services are free of charge to any family that walks through the door. Our focus is East Wake County. About a third of our population are Zebulon residents. Since July 1 of 2016, which is when our fiscal year starts, we have seen over 1,000 duplicated visits from families, and that's huge, and we're growing daily. Today we had 20 children in the resource center. So a day in the resource center starts with song and dance, goes into whatever activity that we're doing, and there's also free play before and after each activity that we do. There's a lot of learning that's done socially that parents don't think about either. We're a little bit unique because parents do stay with their children while they're interacting in whatever activity we have for the day. And our goal is that those parents will go home and model whatever they have seen us do and continue doing that with their children to help continue to prepare them for kindergarten. So your past donations have been used to run our program. We're open Monday through Thursday. Our hours are 9 to 12. And things like craft supplies that we need, any kind of curriculum that we need to run this program are what we use donations like you have given us in the past to use. So we respectfully ask that you keep us in your budget for this coming year. We hope that you can see the importance of what we do and how it helps the community. And I just have one more thing that I wanted to tell you about. We have an annual Stars in the East event that is coming April 6th. It's a time that area schools come together and have a talent show. We have a dinner before the show, and we just want to extend an invitation to all of you to join us for that. And I'd just like to thank you for your time.
Thank you, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Carnell Taylor, Camp ICANN.
To Mayor Matheny and to the Zebulon Board of Commission, I would like to thank you all for this opportunity. As said, my name is Carnell Taylor, and I am the board chair of the North Carolina Family Training and Counseling Center. It has been said that it takes a village to raise a child. And as the town of Zebulon is a part of our village, we are asking for your financial support. The North Carolina Family Training and Counseling Center is a 501c3 organization, and we sponsor Camp ICANN. Camp ICANN has been in existence for over 25 years, and it was founded by Ms. Gladys Todd, which I think you all probably know. We are proud to say that we all can academically sponsor summer camp. We include reading, math, public speaking, gardening, and a few other subjects during the camp. Kids also get a chance to play, but we focus heavily on academics. We have endeavored to employ Wake County certified school teachers, and they are the ones that actually run the camp. And it's our objective to review and to teach children at or above their academic level. So when they go back to school, they'll be farther down the road than when they left. The town of Zebulon has, in the past, for some years, been a sponsor of Camp ICANN. And we are asking for your support as we prepare for the summer of 2017. The camp is open to all Wake County kids, and especially those in the Zebulon area. And we have realized that some kids cannot attend camp due to financial issues. And that's where the town of Zebulon come in. We're asking for your support to enable some of those kids to attend. The money that we receive is spent on classroom materials, field trips, food, building, staff, and of course, assisting those kids that are unable to attend due to financial hardships. We thank you in advance for your generosity and for being a part of our village to prepare our children. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Any more? And I would assume this is Martin Luther King.
Good afternoon to the board, the commission board. I'd like to thank for helping out for this year, and this year will make me 11 years doing this. I am the chairman of the MAK Brookville, and I'd like to thank Bob. He was the speaker for this year, and he did a great job. I had a lot of calls that they enjoyed it, and I had about 262 people at the Zebulon Baptist Church, and I hope y'all help me again for next year, and it'll be 12 years. I would do this again. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Herbert Gray. I'm sorry, Mr. Gray, I don't know what you're going to be speaking on, or I would be happy to tell him, but You can tell us.
I can tell you. Hi, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. I am Herbert Gray. I am the chairman of Progressive Teamwork Outreach Ministry. And I'm here on behalf of our group. Each year for the last 12 years, we've sponsored a back-to-school jamboree in which we provide school supplies to needy children. We started 12 years ago in a park in Zebulon with about 25 students, and it has grown from 25, and this past year we service about 250 students. We've done this solely on donations over the years from churches and individuals and businesses. For the last 3 years, we've had it at the Boys and Girls Club right here in Zebulon. And so we just need support, because sometimes we have a group that may support us 1 year, and the next year they don't. It started out just me and my wife doing it ourselves, and that kind of got kind of expensive. But we think it's important that we send our children back with the basic school supplies needed for school. And so not only the school supplies we give them, but we have other organizations in Zebulon that come and we distribute school supplies. This past year, we had the food market from Zebulon. They were there and gave out some food. So we have different organizations that come at the Boys and Girls Club to share what they do in addition to the school supplies that we give our children. So we just respectfully ask for your support as we understand that it's important that we send our children back with the basic school supplies. And not only that, in closing, we always get their information from every student. And so throughout the school year, we contact those students to see if that need still exists for them. And we try to keep school supplies on hand. The last thing Progressive Teamwork does is each Thursday night, we have a food pantry that we provide food to needy families in Zebulon. We do that every Thursday night from 6:30 to 7:30 at 112 each East Church Street right here in Zebulon. So thank you so much for your time and have a great evening.
Thank you very much. Jerry Hayes. Lisa.
Good evening. As you just heard, my name is Sherry Hayes. I'm here tonight actually representing two different organizations that put in a request for funding. And I'd just like to say thank you for putting this in the budget as even an opportunity for us to apply for. In the interest of sticking to my time, I'm going to read some notes. The Zebulon Swimming Pool Association was created by local parents to build and maintain a community pool in the town of Zebulon. It was built on land donated by the Whitley family of Whitley Galleries. It's been in operation for 56 years. It was the first and still is the most affordable and accessible pool in the area. We believe that we are providing a resource for our citizens that the town currently is not. The other closest pools are 5 miles away at the Zebulon Country Club and 3 miles away in Weaver's Pond. It's $800 the first year to get into the Country Club, you can't join Weaver's Pond unless you live there. Our goal as our board is to continue to make swimming accessible to as many residents as possible. Every year we offer three sessions of American Red Cross swimming lessons and advertise and market that to non-members. The bulk of the people in our lessons are non-members. And so that helps us to contribute to reducing deaths by drowning, which is one of the leading causes of death in young children. We allow members and non-members also to rent the pool for birthday parties or team celebrations or whatever. We believe, and we could get you harder numbers, but somewhere between 300 and 500 people enjoyed our facility in 2016. We have branched out and reached out to child care centers, and between that and our swim team and private rentals and agreements with local fitness centers to have that as an additional benefit, that's where we came up with those numbers. The other thing that I'd like to note is that about a third of our annual budget is payroll, and that basically for the most part, is paid to teenagers here in Zebulon who have gone through lifeguarding class and that we then hire. So a lot of that money is providing jobs for the kids right here in town. So your $1,000 grant would help ensure that we are able to celebrate our 60th anniversary in 2020. And with your help, we look forward to many more years of providing a safe aquatic facility that is accessible to the residents of Zebulon. So.
Thank you.
Unless y'all have any questions about that, I'm gonna switch hats and talk to you about the Zebulon swim team. Barnan Wilder Creech, who some of you may know, founded the Zebulon swim team. This will be the 20th year of the Zebulon swim team. Zebulon swim team is a 501c3, and I forgot to say the pool is a 501c7, but we're both nonprofit. The swim team offers a low-cost, high-quality swim program that ensures Zebulon kids ages 3 to 18 are safe around water and learn how to swim. We teach the breaststroke, backstroke, butterfly, freestyle, dives, flip turns, and competition rolls. The best thing to me about the swim team is that the older kids work with and encourage the younger kids, which is something you don't see a lot in a lot of places. When the little kids are swimming, the big kids are right there cheering for them. Often with the tiny ones, they are catchers is what they're called, but they can catch them. If they catch them, then their race doesn't count. But if they need caught, we catch them. But once they don't need that, then they wait for them at the end of the lane to catch them. Because starting at 3, obviously we're teaching them to swim. They're not necessarily ready for competition when they start. We have had, in the last 6 years, we have had 3 of our swimmers win college scholarships. So, and we participate in the Tar Heel Swim Association, which has literally over 100 teams, and many of those teams have over 100 members. Just to give you some perspective, we had 37 on our team last year. So we're a small team, but we really feel like we are doing a lot of good things. Let me check out my notes here. The number of people that we serve has ranged from 30 to 60 people on the team each year. For 19 years, this will be our 20th year. But every child has to have at least one grown-up, I'll call them, involved, whether it's mom, dad, aunt, uncle, because all of the meets are run by parents. There's no paid officials, although there are still plenty of things that we need to cost money, like lights that you're required to have, and so we have to rent those, among other things. So if you look at that 30 to 60 kids per year, then you got to double that at least for the parents, and that would give you an idea of how many people are involved. So I think I calculated that would be over our 19 years, around somewhere between 1,700 and 2,200 lives who that have been affected by swim team. So again, I thank you for your time, and if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, that concludes our list of people that requested to speak. This will be considered later. The grants will be considered later as we progress with our budget. Next, we have community and economic development update.
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. I'm Denise Nowell, and on behalf of the Zebulon Chamber of Commerce, our board of directors, and the members we represent, we're here to share our second scheduled update relating to their partnership between us for economic development and for the good of the community for Zebulon. I'll quickly mention highlights from this year's agreements, then share relative areas of progress based on what's occurred since your update that you received from us back in December. So key points from that 2016-17 agreement partnership included, first, the chamber partnering with the town to create local job opportunities, hosting an economic forum, organizing and hosting a mentorship and support program for businesses, and attending an economic development course at UNC's School of Government. Second was the chamber partnering with the town to recognize and support local agriculture and farming businesses as important contributors to the local economy, particularly vendors from the Farm Fresh Market, organizing and hosting May Day in Zebulon, and generally promoting the Farm Fresh Market. Third was the chamber partnering with the town to promote downtown through special events. So relating to the first point, in December we shared results from the Zebulon Next Economic Growth Conference in October. The event brought together local, community, and regional leaders to engage in an economic development conversation focused on Zebulon. Last month, Mark Andrews with TME Investments, who spoke at Zebulon Next, announced a new tenant coming to Triangle East Business Park. Tethys will open a manufacturing facility this fall with initial projections for hiring 15 to 20 employees. While hosting Zebulon Next may not appear to be directly linked to the Tethys decision, collaborating with Mark Andrews to speak and attend at Zebulon Next allowed him to convey his passion for Zebulon, and so it was no surprise that he was actually advocating for this community. Tethys is going to be another strong tenant at Triangle East Business Park and a nice addition to the town of Zebulon. Another positive byproduct from Zebulon Next was in the form of new momentum that we want to leverage as we move forward and tell our story. At last week's annual meeting, we unveiled a video that the community can use as a tool, and it's going to be able to do just that. We'd like to share it this evening, and so I've got that for you guys to see, and I appreciate that most of you got to see it at last week's event.
The draw for the Greater Raleigh region is a great combination of things. We have incredible universities, a really strong community college system, great quality of life coupled with a reasonable cost of living, and wonderful access to amenities.
The Raleigh area is already attracting trailblazers, and more than that, I think they're making them here. They're coming out of the universities, startup places like Hub and American Underground. And
Zebulon is on the verge of an explosive growth, and we have a lot of things to offer.
The Zebulon Chamber of Commerce is doing a great job of pulling those business leaders together so that we're all involved and know the growth that's coming in, and we can plan together.
One of the ways, a town can make itself more attractive is education. There are programs like Certified Work Ready Communities that can be very, very valuable.
Zebulon's really at a point now when they realize that Lake County is expected to double in population, double, over the next four decades.
The success of small towns really has to do with embracing their authentic selves and really leveraging the resources and the assets of the entire region. And Zebulon's done a great job of that. They've already been a tremendous job center, but now looking at where do they want residential growth to go.
As far as a population growth trajectory for Zebulon, it's probably going to be something, the doubling of what's here right now. I think the question is how quickly can that occur? The Beaver Dam Outfall project is going to open up a section of town that currently could not develop because there was no infrastructure service to that area.
We see that expansion continues to happen in all of Wake County. So right now, the place that's headed is east.
It's all about leadership and planned growth, just ensuring that we've got that kind of, long-term plan to ensure we can keep, the green space, the quality of life, all the things that are necessary that, virtually everyone wants when they move to a community.
We think that's going to be a very great tool for not only the town but also the community to use as we continue talking about Zebulon and promoting ourselves and being our own voice for what
we're going to see. Not all homes are created equal. Neither are real estate professionals. So who
Thank
can you.
You
trust to sell your home quickly and for top
oh,
dollar?
See. I see this. X.
Meet Cindy Lux and Amira.
There you go. Okay, thanks.
Hey, I'm glad to know I'm not the only one to mess it up.
Right. Just find an X somewhere, right? Later this month, also connected to that point, was that later this month I'll attend the first session of the UNC School of Government's Community Development Academy and then return for a second session in April. Then as the agreement relates to promoting local agriculture and engaging farm fresh market vendors, the next big push for promoting farm fresh market will be through May Day in Zebulon. That will be on Saturday, May the 6th. In conversations already with Greg Johnson, we'll be increasing visibility again this year by promoting the 5K race, Farm Fresh Market, the Mudcats, and a few other organizations that have events on that same day. The goal, again, will be to promote a family-friendly day of events for the community and surrounding area. Start time for the 5K this year will be an hour later at 10 a.m. to give participants more opportunity to experience the market. The later end time is a strategy that we'll use to encourage participants and their families to visit local restaurants and get to know a little bit more about our town of friendly people. Then under the third point, which addresses the promotion of downtown, much of this was covered in the details of our December report for holiday happenings. Just a quick review, that Saturday pop-up street vendor market brought 31 businesses to the downtown. Over half of those were actually local businesses to our area. Five of those were our Farm Fresh Market vendors. We were able to track 150 attendees in the first 2 hours of the market. Partnering with Public Works made it easy for vendors to sell from a space that was already set up with tents and tables. Having Santa at the market in the afternoon meant families brought their kids, which equated to steady traffic for the vendors. Then the evening's caroling and tree lighting brought another 60 to 80 people downtown, which was another example of collaboration. Five churches and one school participated in the caroling, which was really a sweet time. Then the Christmas parade, it continues to be a strong partnership between the town and the chamber, and I feel like we continue to make improvements. And while we couldn't control the weather, we are already working on increasing the number of vans for 2017. And then pulling this all together, some noteworthy items that I feel like are helpful is in terms of economic development for Zebulon. The continued exposure that the town is receiving right now from our Citizen of the Year, John Middlesworth, was already interviewed by and featured by ABC 11 last Monday. There's a link to that if you're interested. He's also been considered for an interview with Truckers News. We got a call from them late last week. And then Eastwake News is also planning to do a piece on him. The chamber recently met with the town's planning department to strengthen understanding of roles and relationships as we begin entertaining more conversations about economic growth, questions about zoning, general inquiries about what's next for Zebulon. We want to make sure that we're out in front of the conversations so that when folks come to us that we have as much information as we need and that we can point them in the right direction. And then last, as part of promoting our communities and promoting specifically education, the National Read Across America campaign last week, the chamber promoted that. We actually had some inside knowledge from a couple of folks that are connected to us as teachers, and we helped promote it through our membership. And then we also had our staff go and read. We participated in 12 different classrooms reading to some kids between kindergarten and fifth grade. So it was a fun week. And I feel like those are the kinds of things that continue moving us forward as far as economic development and growth goes for Zebulon. So can I answer any questions?
Anybody have questions? Thank you very much.
Well, on behalf of the board and our members, we appreciate the support and we can continue to look forward to where we're going. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, and we now move into planning, and the first is a Weaver's Pond final plat approval and acceptance of roadways and storm drainage. Julie?
Good evening. In the interest of time, since I'm going to be up here for the next three cases, I don't have much in way of PowerPoint. For the final plat, we included in your packet a printout of the final plat. We included attachments for all the documents. We have the punch list ready. We have the checklist ready. We have the guarantees, warranties, and certifications that were needed for the final plat. Staff is comfortable and recommends approval, and we're going to put that before the board. Do you have any questions on the final plat?
Any questions? Excuse me, any questions? Okay, let's go ahead and break it down. Is there a motion to approve final plat phase 2D? Weaver's Pond.
So move.
Second.
Made and second. Comments? Discussion? All in favor? Okay.
For the resolution, I believe Lisa passed out the correct resolution. There was a misprint on the one that was included in your packet. So the resolution that was passed out tonight includes the update for the station numbers from, I think it had 2900, and it should be 29 plus 75 for one of the stations. So that resolution, that 2017-11, is now updated for the corrected stations.
Okay. Does anyone have a question? Is there a motion to adopt resolution 2017-11?
So moved.
Second.
Motion made and second. Any comments or discussion? All in favor? And the motion carries.
All right, great.
Thank you, ma'am. All right, we now move to special use 2017-02, Autumn Lakes.
Again, in the interest of time, I have the PowerPoint that was on record for the joint public hearing and the attachments ready at your disposal. I will not go over the slides unless you need some clarification or points. I will quickly go over some of the stuff that was entered into hearing. So just to remind you some of the things that we were talking about. We had a conditions packet that was proposed conditions by staff. Almost all the conditions were agreed to previously through staff meetings by the developer. There were some things that did change. At the public hearing, we had two conditions that we wanted to amend, conditions 24 and 25. We had some parks and recreation and amenities changes. We were going to change the time and the phasing of the parks. So we had agreed to that as staff and the developer, so just wanted to point that condition out to you. We had proposed there would be a fee in lieu for the 150 feet of forward storage at site drive 2 and site drive 1, and then the fee in lieu for the additional turn lanes at the intersections of 97 and Old Bun Road and Shepherd School Road, and that the fee in lieu should be paid before the issuance of the 330 certificate of occupancy, which is the 60% build out for the development phase. The developer had a counter proposal to staff's conditions offering to pay a proportion of the fee in lieu, and they've offered to do one of the turn lanes in the intersections for site drive, but not for the second site drive. So the planning board made a minor recommendation for those, and when we get to the planning board recommendations part, I will call Kenny Waldrop up here to give you that presentation. So I'll let him handle that and his recommendation from the planning board. We did have some greenway conditions as well. The staff was not proposing that the greenway for Corridor 2 be part of their tract, as it was an off-site improvement. The planning board did have a condition for that. Again, they'll talk to you as part of their recommendations for that. The water and sewer allocation, we did recommend that you look at the overall allocation for the subdivision. The final allocation request will be for 264,000 gallons per day. We are requesting that we look at that at final plat time and allocate at final plat and not allocate with the special use permit, so we can keep the allocation requests going and have that 4% growth rate tallied in whenever we do those projections for the allocation. So we are requesting that the condition for the water and sewer allocation to limit the request to 200 dwelling units per final plat or 50,000 gallons per day for final plat. We had some conditions for overall aesthetics and Under the general code for residential one and two family dwellings, we are allowed to, as part of the special use, request certain conditions. All those conditions for a one-stall garage, for conditions on foundations, building materials, and the heated square footage were agreed to by the developer. And we have proposed the rest of the conditions, or various conditions for site plan approval, lot sizes and widths, signage, setbacks, recreation, greenways, transportation, street lighting, landscaping, streetscaping buffers, preserving rock outcrops, the Beaver Dam Creek sanitary sewer outfall assessment fees, open space preservation, mailbox kiosks, blasting adherence to all town ordinances and policies, and homeowners associated responsibilities. All those are agreed to by the developer. So, that was a lot to go through. If you have any questions, I'd be willing to answer them.
I do have some questions on the proposed conditions that I don't know if this is the appropriate time or if I need to wait until Kenny.
We can do that now, or you can wait till the planning board does the recommendation part, and then you can call me back up. And
let's do both. That.
Okay.
Let's hear
so next, I'm going to call Kenny Waldrop up, and he will do the planning board recommendation that they came to from their planning board meeting.
Please stay up. I will. Thank you, ma'am. I'll try to be brief. Your planning board met immediately after the joint public hearing and approved a recommendation to you to approve the special use permit with conditions by a 6-0 vote. The conditions that were recommended were 69 conditions that staff and the developer had worked out. And then there were the five conditions that Julie mentioned, two of which, condition 24 and 25, was a modification accepted by staff that the developer recommended. Condition 33 was a recommendation by your planning board to keep staff's position on that condition. Condition 34 was the planning board's recommendation for a slight amendment to the developer's condition by striking the language subject to NCDOT requirements. Likewise, on condition 35, the planning board recommended a slight amendment to the developer's condition to strike the language subject to NCDOT requirements. Finally, the planning board turned to additional conditions. A motion was made and seconded and approved to add a condition to mimic or to add the same language for a greenway culvert assessment that was recommended to the board for the Barrington project to this project, Autumn Lakes. Afterwards, the planning board made a motion and seconded and passed a recommendation to this board of commissioners to consider a policy of assessing the greenway culvert crossing. With that, I stand ready for any questions.
Okay, I'll start. 24 and 25, there's no, everybody's on board with that. So on 34 and 35, it says a slight amendment to the developer's condition to strike the language. I'm a little bit confused on that because when I look at 34 and 35, I don't see that language in there.
That was a separate attachment for the developer's proposal of the conditions. So it's not actually in the staff proposed conditions. It's in the next attachment for the developer's proposed conditions. But I do have them loaded on the slide if you'd like me to bring it up.
I'd like to see what we're doing there. I'm, like I say, a little bit confused on it.
See all these slides I didn't have to go through? Aren't you guys happy? All right, so here's condition 34. And this is the one that's included in your packet for staff proposed. And this is the proposed condition by the developer. And subject to NCDOT requirements is what the planning board recommended removal of as their recommendation of this condition.
So basically, that's the same for 34 and 35.
It's yes. It's the same for 34 and 35.
Just to. Okay.
One's for the Old Bun Road and Shepherd School Road intersection, and one is for the Fee and Lieu for the 97 and Old Bun intersection.
I'm curious why the developer would not want that. Do you have a sense to that?
Curious as to why the developer would not want subject to NCDOT requirements?
Right.
They put that in there. The planning board moved to strike the language. So as the developer...
Then why? I mean, I don't understand what's going on here.
Okay. Well, it was upon the assumption that there could be a period when plans might be submitted. And depending on the sequencing of the various projects out there, it may not cross a threshold that DOT would recognize and then require those improvements. So we suggested striking that language so we wouldn't have DOT tripping up over successive projects and failing to know exactly what was happening along the entire length of the road.
Okay, well, that helps a lot, thank you. Would you go over condition 33 one more time? Let me see if I can grasp that one as well.
All right, on the site plan, and I can pull the site plan up if it's easier for you to see site drive one and site drive two, but the turn lanes for site drive one and site drive two were recommended to have a minimum 100 feet full width storage for drive one, and for drive two, a minimum of 150 feet of a turn lane. And the proposed condition by the developer is to have a right-hand turn lane at site drive two that was not warranted, but they would do the left turn lane into the site drive one according to the NCDOT requirements. So they agreed to do one of the two turn lanes that staff is proposing.
Is the reason that that is a proposed change is that there was no crossing of other lanes to turn in on the right-hand turn?
I do not know why the developer was proposing not to do the site two drive, except that they said it was not warranted. They are here if you need a clarification.
Well, and that's fine. I'm not sure they could re-enter more evidence anyway. I just was thinking that because of the right-hand turn, they didn't have to cross any lanes.
I think it was based on the traffic counts that they did not feel a turn lane was necessarily needed into the development, and it was, especially with the turn lane at site drive one, site drive two wouldn't necessarily have the same amount of traffic to require a turn lane.
But the planning board, again, just for the audience, is recommending that we leave both turn lanes.
Yes. That's correct.
Okay.
And that's in recognition of the fact that you've got two rather large projects on the same road that are coming in, and they're planning essentially in isolation. And your staff correctly recommended some joint planning and conditions thereof.
Okay.
Can you do you have a site plan to show exactly what we're talking about here?
Site drive one and site drive two.
Now explain to me the difference between site one and site two, why you wouldn't want to have the turn lane in site two. I mean, I know y'all recommended that, so it's a bit...
Because you have another subdivision just across the roadway that's going to have significant traffic counts also. And there was concern that the cumulative effect was not properly considered when looking at the subdivisions in isolation. So we are recommending your staff's recommendation to be inclusive of those two turn lanes.
So you're recommending two turn lanes then?
Yeah.
Right, okay.
On both site one and two.
All right.
Right. Other questions? Do you have anything else, either of you?
No, I think
so. Okay.
Okay,
let's work through the numbered conditions first. 24 and 25, is there any discussion on that?
That's good.
condition 33, the one we were just talking about, before we take a motion, I want to be sure we craft
what we're going
to do. Does anybody have any thoughts as to?
I think we ought to. I think we ought to go by the staff's recommendation.
Staff's recommendation.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Everybody in agreement on that? Okay. 34 and 35. Staff does not recommend subject to NCDOT. Our planning board doesn't, and the developer does want it.
I'm going with the town recommendation.
Town's recommendation. Everybody in agreement with that? Any disagreement?
I don't have any problem with that.
Okay. All right. So all these conditions would be as recommended by staff and or the planning board. Now we get down to the addition of an assessment for Greenway Culvert. Eric, I believe you have some comments that we need to hear on that.
Sure, I'll set the table a little bit for the board. The proposal is to create an assessment for Autumn Lake's lot sales that's similar to the assessment that was crafted for the Barrington subdivision. The Barrington subdivision was a unique situation. The assessment was crafted as a compromise, if you'll remember, for a connectivity obligation that would have been difficult and possibly impossible to create. And that would be a crossing by culvert or some other means of 64 highway. The problem with trying to transfer a similar obligation to Autumn Lakes is there is no current policy with the town of Zebulon to impose that type of impact fee. And all conditions with regard to a special use permit must be based on existing policies, ordinances, or other articulated goals of the town. So in my opinion, this proposed condition, although understandable and well-meaning, is not appropriate for Autumn Lakes, even though it was for Barrington. In fact, I would go so far as to say it would be illegal to impose this on Autumn Lakes.
Thank you, Eric. Any questions for the attorney? And I, for clarification, I believe that Barrington was tying in two pieces of property that they owned.
That's correct.
Whereas, yeah. Okay. Other questions or discussions on any of this? What's your pleasure?
I'll make a motion. We accept SU 2017-02 with all the conditions except for the last one pertaining to the culvert.
Okay, for clarification, all the conditions proposed by our staff and
correct.
Planning board.
Correct.
Okay. Again, excluding the assessment. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Comments? All in favor? And the motion carries. Thank you all very much. All right, Zebulon Green. Julie?
Again, Zebulon Green, we have another 50-some slides to go through. I'm going to skip them in the essence of time, but I do have them here to zoom around to if we need to look at either the site plan or any of the conditions listed. So to go through briefly again, there is no TIA for this development as they are not creating 100 trips or more for this site. There is no coordinating Greenway Bicycle Master Plan proponents to the site, although this site does have some recreation amenities in the site itself, interconnectivity of sidewalks between the buildings, some walking trails, some playground areas with tot lots, some benches and waste stations. And in the original proposed conditions, we had talked about pet waste stations. Pets will not be allowed on site, so the developer and staff had agreed to remove the conditions of pet waste stations from that condition. With the water and sewer allocation policy, we are asking that you do approve water and sewer allocation for this site as part of the special use permit. They are not going to be developing in phases. They will be coming in one phase through TRC, and they are going to have a maximum of 72 units. And so we're doing the request for a maximum of 72 units. The water irrigation meter, the office building with a part of the community building is going to have office with an office staff, a bathroom, kitchenette for the community building, and then a laundry facility. So I've included those calculations, but the overall calculation for the site is listed as 26,000 gallons per day. And part of the TRC process, we will turn any allocation back over to the town that is not used as part of the site plan approval process. If there is less than 72 units, that way we have a correct allocation for the site. That way we don't have more in the books than what is necessarily needed. So their request is for the 26,000 gallons per day. Again, we are asking that you do approve that water sewer allocation as part of this policy. The Parks and Recreation Master Plan, we've gone over a little bit of the things that will be included in that. There is no part of the, we don't have a Parks and Recreation Master Plan overall. However, we do have some recreation amenities on the sites. The other ordinance requirements that are on the sites that the staff has worked out with conditions with the developer that were all approved by the developer before we submitted the application packet. They agreed to every other condition that we had. And it was on site plan approval, the foundations, the exterior building materials, signage, setbacks, street lighting, landscaping, streetscaping buffers, preserving rock outcrops, open space preservation, mailbox kiosks, blasting adherence to all town ordinances and policies, and managers association responsibilities. So we had a long list of conditions, and they agreed to everything. And then again, we made that amendment for removing the pet waste stations, as pets will not be allowed on site. For the planning board recommendation, and the staff report, it does say that Daryl Jones will be here. Instead, we have Kenny, since he was presenting before. Kenny's going to stand up, back up and give you the recommendation for the planning board. And if you don't have any questions for me on the staff report, I'll let him come up.
Go ahead. Kenny?
Yeah. Your planning board met immediately following the joint public hearing. Members Gene Blunt and Sam Hayes could not be in attendance that night. The planning board approved the recommendation of the special use permit with conditions by a vote of 3-2 at a voice vote for the meeting on February 13th. The planning board recommended approval of 44 conditions as recommended by the staff and supported by the applicant, amended one condition, and added a condition for a total of 46. Condition 16, the planning board recommended the developer changes as requested and agreed to by the staff to remove, quote, two dog waste stations, unquote. A condition was then added to clarify that there shall be a management association. After a discussion of the whole, the vote was 3-2 to recommend approval with conditions as amended based upon the collective judgment of the majority that all findings of fact have been satisfactorily proven by the applicant.
Questions?
Kenny, will you explain the management association, please?
Yes, there was some concern that there's quite a bit of reliance within the conditions upon a management association, but there wasn't a condition that required there be a management association. Well, so that's just a foundational piece to ensure that all the other conditions that reference that entity could stand on a condition that said there will be one.
And what does that mean?
Well,
somebody there will be available 24 hours a day, or how does that work? since there's going to be 72 units, that's going to be problems 24 hours a day.
If Kenny doesn't mind, I'll step in and speak to that. During the hearing, we did hear the developer and applicant speak to the management portion of the site. They own, develop, and maintain the site themselves as part of United Developers, and that is a requirement for 30 years as part of their development agreement. So that management firm does do the maintenance on site. While they might not have office hours open 24/7, they will have a maintenance number and emergency numbers posted at the office, so that if there is an emergency, you can call those numbers and they will come out and assess the situation and mitigate whatever needs to happen. So the rest of the management association firm duties would be making sure that junk cars are removed, making sure that landscape maintenance is maintained, that there's no rubbish and trash collection is happening as it needs to be, and those types of things to make sure that the site is functionally normally and that we don't have to issue any notices of violation for public safety, health, or welfare.
That would be conditions 7 through 12 in reference to how the property will be managed.
Yeah.
The applicant themselves acquitted themselves very well in terms of how they are managing their other properties. The language is in here is try to be inclusive of the fact that they may not always be the management firm.
Thank you.
Okay, other questions? I have one is with regards to the dog waste stations, and I understand that apparently they're not going to allow pets. Does that mean that no pets are allowed, like from visitors, or?
I can't speak towards the visitors. I'm not certain, since that question wasn't asked during the public hearing, if that is allowed as an answer. But I can say that I did ask about service animals. If someone is disabled and needs to have a service animal with them in the apartment, if they would then put a waste station in for that service animal, and they did answer yes. So that is not considered a pet station. It's necessarily for the disabled.
But so, it's in here stipulating they have agreed to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I just want to be clear on that, because I mean, somebody could bring pets and walk them and whatnot. Okay. Other questions?
Just one comment. Mr. Owen alluded to in his presentation, there will be no on-site maintenance program. Your maintenance, as I understand it, comes from Fayetteville or off site. Again, this was not addressed in any way whatsoever. I understand trash pickup and I understand fire protection and whatever, but you do tend occasionally to have emergency maintenance problems. And it's just a concern of mine that there is no on-site maintenance there at all. That's a comment.
And you can write that as part of the condition if you want some on-site maintenance. You can craft one of the maintenance conditions to say that you would like somebody on-site, or to have a local firm that would be able to respond within an hour of the call, or however you want to craft that language.
I don't know how you all feel about that. I just had a little concern.
I would think that to have somebody sitting there waiting for something to happen would be overkill.
Maybe.
You know. But having made agreements with local vendors, if you will, for emergency situations, I would think that was something they would do anyway. If they had like a burst water line or something mm-hmm. like that, mm-hmm. did you have any of that discussion?
We did not.
Okay.
We did have them then the discussion that there would be some maintenance agreement and that the number would be posted, but we didn't talk about response times or how they would service that if there was an emergency. Typically, if it's a water main bust, you'd be calling City Raleigh public utilities instead of the apartment maintenance complex. So it depends on where the water main burst is. If it's a hot water tank, that would be a maintenance issue. If it's a service line going into the apartment, that might be a public utilities issue. So it depends on where the leak is, that who would be taking care of it.
Okay. Satisfies me, I don't have a problem.
I'm not real sure how to handle that one, but without making it a requirement, could we convey our concerns? And that may not satisfy you, Don.
It does. Yeah. It satisfies me. All I wanted to do was comment on it.
I mean, if a water heater goes out, that's one thing. If it burst, that's something else.
Right.
And there needs to be some methodology for adequate response in that emergency type situation. If a water line breaks, City of Raleigh's meter is going to keep running. So that's an emergency to the tenant, but not necessarily the City of Raleigh. And I'm not kidding. I know the response is adequate, so I'm not, you know, throwing stones here. But the emergency is to the individual, its importance, you know, how they view it. And beyond that, reasonable response time. But would y'all be in agreement just to convey to them that concern that they try to approach that, or do you think we should put something in here?
Well, you know, if it's 0 degrees at night and the heat goes out, how long will it be for somebody to respond to it? You know, I'm not comfortable with 72 units and nobody's there to be responsible. I've been to a lot of, there's always somebody at an apartment complex that's responsible that you can go to and say, hey, get somebody here quick. I'm just not comfortable with that, Julie.
Yeah, I would say that at the public hearing, we heard Bill Owen testify that he has over 4,000 other units that they do maintain and manage, and that of those times there's been probably at least one emergency that he's comfortable mitigating. So while that might not be something we can bring up now for him to testify against how he plans on mitigating any emergencies on our site, I do believe that he's got the experience necessary that he'll be able to manage the site well, given his testimony at the hearing. And knowing that there is at least an emergency number posted on site for somebody to get that call started will at least put the ball in motion.
It probably should be posted on every door in the apartment, like a hotel, you know.
Other comments?
But,
okay, sorry.
No, I'm confident with how you feel, Julie.
I think if we require something like that, I think it's a little overkill myself.
It's a what?
He believes
it's overkill to require it.
Okay.
Other comments? All right, are we ready to act, or you want to make proposed modifications? Somebody?
I make a motion we approve special use 2017-03 with the conditions as listed.
As proposed by the planning board?
Yes.
Okay.
Second.
Motion made and second. Other comments or discussion? All in favor? Motion carries. Thank you very much. Historic preservation.
Good evening, Mayor, members of the board. I want to recap some of the historic preservation discussions that occurred. The first one began on around September 21st, which was a board work session where we had a representative from State Historic Preservation Office, Also had Capital Area Preservation Representative and a representative from the Wake County Planning Department as well, who discussed the federal and local historic preservation programs that were available to the town. On January 18th, based on the interest that we received from the board, we tried to get some direction on creating a Historic Preservation Commission, designating Wake County Historic Preservation Commission to enforce the ordinance, and then or just to decline continued interest in historic preservation efforts. Based on the feedback, staff has returned tonight with an interlocal agreement between Wake County, which would designate Wake County Historic Preservation Commission, the authority to exercise the powers and duties given to it by the Wake County Historic Preservation Ordinance, and that would be within the Town of Zebulon's planning jurisdiction, which is the corporate limits and ETJ. I will say that the interlocal agreement was based off of our attorney's review of the 1992 agreement and more or less updating and to the current ILA kind of standards and signature blocks and things of that nature. But it was sent out to Wake County and Capital Area Preservation for their comments, and the comments that were received were incorporated into the draft that is before you tonight. So the discussion tonight is whether or not to sign the interlocal agreement, which would adopt by reference, again, the Wake County Historic Preservation Ordinance as approved and attached in Attachment B, and then allow the Wake County Historic Preservation Commission the authority to exercise its power given to it by the ordinance over our jurisdiction. I will say the there is a difference in the National Register Program, which is the federal program, and this is kind of a official list of properties, buildings, or sites that basically the federal government deems worthy of preserving. It is kind of a property list that kind of honors and shows those designations. It doesn't have as part of it, or doesn't obligate or restrict a private owner unless that owner is wanting to get some tax credit benefit. So being on the National Register, if there is a group that submits a survey and includes it, has the public hearings and things of that nature, there won't be any restrictions on owners, even if the owners don't want to be within that district, since there are only 75% of the property owners within the area would petition. So there may be some owners included within that designation, but it's more just you know, which properties within that area are worthy of being preserved. A local district, however, will say that there are no local districts in Wake County or any of the municipalities that have merged with Wake County for the enforcement. It is more or less a zoning overlay on top of these properties, which would then present additional, depending on how it's structured, would then put some additional layers and requirements potentially on properties within that. The cost associated with the enforcement of these programs would be one borne by the town, and it would not be enforced by Wake County due to the increased level of possible reviews and approvals within that. Due to some of the sensitivities of property owners and local historic districts, these probably would not be something that Capital Area Preservation or the county, for that matter, would petition and bring before you. It would more or less be something that you would want to do within our jurisdiction. I will make a note that the State Historic Preservation Office has applied for a grant to survey all the properties within Zebulon's corporate limits and ETJ. It's covered, 60% of the grant is covered by the state and 40% is covered by the county, so there is no cost to the town for the survey. And it basically is used for any property owners that may be wishing to seek a National Register district, and so it kind of provides a survey of the existing properties within the town, since one has not been done in a very long time. It would not make recommendations for districts, and it doesn't create any districts or obligate the town to create any districts, only there again if certain owners or properties want to be included and apply for tax district incentives. Local district, or local landmarks, I'm sorry, is a designation and kind of an honor of the property. There again, it doesn't put any requirements on certain particular properties. It's more just a honor that the property is being preserved and kind of gives some of the history of that. There again, if there's some property owners that have a local landmark that do want to go after some of the tax defers or incentives, then they're able to do that within the program. But that's about all the information I have tonight. If you have any specific questions on the ordinance itself or interlocal agreement or process in general.
Well, I apologize that I was not here at the work session. I had an unexpected trip to Georgia and could not be here. So I have a few questions, and I don't want anybody to interpret this as me being against this. I just want clarification. As I understand it, if it's a landmark application, it's paid for by the county. If it's a local historic district, it's paid for by the town.
That's correct.
Okay. How is a potential historic district established?
A potential local?
Yes.
It would be likely, since Wake County or Capital Area Preservation would not bring those before you, it would be something that some property owners may have interest in creating a local district, and then ultimately it would be up to this board to determine whether or not they wanted a district on however many properties it may include.
Well, I mean, the reason I'm asking that question is this is where we got tangled up with them before, and I never got a clear answer on it. My understanding is that North Arundel has been designated as a potential historic district, which means nothing unless something is being built in conjunction with a federal organization or federal money. So how did that get established as a potential district, and are there any others that we have that we don't know of?
I think that was done prior to the, I believe the 92 survey is when that goes back, because it was kind of a hand-drawn survey. I believe there were also some properties included on Gannon as well, and I think it may have included some of the properties downtown as well. But that was part of a survey that was done that those potential properties may be have historic nature, and certainly I think that was part of why the state is applying for the grant to update the survey, since it hasn't been done since then, and certainly there's been a lot of changes over time with development up and down Arundel, certainly. For properties that may need to be pulled out of that initial survey and then just updated as to some of the properties in general as it relates to the town. But you're correct, it was only if federal funds or monies were involved.
So is there some way to, and you said pull them out, but is there some way to resolve that issue?
I think the new survey that this grant would cover would then update and pull out those properties that would no longer qualify for historic nature.
But doing the survey, does that establish a potential district?
It updates the properties for that. It wouldn't necessarily create a new district. Now, if a survey was done and we may have some other say a bank come in within that area, would they then be reviewed under it being a potential, even though one wasn't created? That may still come into play as well.
And that's where it came into play. There was a bank, it was tied in with the FDIC. Mm-hmm. And it really, they tried to overstep their bounds, and we pointed that out, so they backed off. And for clarification, they tried to say what could be done inside the building as opposed to what could be done outside. But in any event, I just, my question about it is to avoid any surprises as opposed, you know, to any other motivation. It's just, we need to know. If somebody comes into you and talks about something, you need to know. So
I think the survey would assist those property owners that may wish to create a National Register designation for certain properties, but it wouldn't obligate the town to create a local district as a result.
I understand they wouldn't cause us to do a local district. What I'm wondering is, does it mitigate the ability to come in and have sway over something to do with federal money or federal, like a bank, are they still under that?
My understanding is any properties that would come in as a result of the updated survey would still fall under that, should federal monies be involved.
Okay. All right. Most of my questions got answered, but if y'all will bear with me just a minute, let me go through my notes. It does say that it would designate a joint preservation commission between the county of Wake and the town of Zebulon, but in actuality, we're not guaranteed a membership spot on that commission. There's only, as I read it, seven, one for each district of Wake County that's to that board. Am I correct on that?
I believe it has to have nine members on the board and up no more than 12.
Okay.
And last time I talked to Gary about that, they were at the max of 12. But as soon as someone comes off, they would then try to get someone from Zebulon to represent our area. So they do want to have one person from each area at least.
Yeah, and that's what I'd like to see. I'd just like to see us have representation if we're going to, you know, put something in their basket, so to speak. What if we fail to enforce? We fail to enforce the conditions of the historic landmark, or if they issue us a letter and say they're in violation, you said it's our job to enforce it.
That's only if the town wishes to create a local district. Any
in districts only?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't understand that. So that's why I'm asking questions. Okay. But if it was a district and we didn't enforce it and we said, okay, yeah, you can go ahead and build a modern building there.
A lot of the review, approval, and enforcement is done, the county contracts with Capital Area Preservation for that. So unless we're creating a local district, we would kind of be under their umbrella for that as well.
Well, I thought you were going to say the answer is they come down on us to enforce it, which they should if it's our job. But anyway, I won't dwell on that. Got that. And to be clear, before any landmark or historic district local can be designated, the final approval rests with this board.
That's correct.
Okay. Is that true for National Historic?
For the district itself, no, it is not. I think if there's 75% of the property owner's petition to be included, it doesn't need, because it really has no bearing on the town itself. It's right. More of a status. It would not require final approval. It's only the local landmarks and local districts that would.
Right. And as you pointed out, there are no local districts in Wake County. They're all.
Now, there's some, I think, historic downtown, things of that nature. But as far as a local historic district,
right.
There's none.
Right. Okay. Be clear that under the landmark application is made by the landowner.
That's correct.
The district, if we were to have a local district, and I just want to be clear, is that they could do nothing to the exterior of the building that changes it without the approval of this commission.
My understanding, even for landmarks, they're able to make any alterations that they wish, but it's only when they're going for tax deferrals that the requirements come into play.
So if they were in a district, but there's no tax credits in a district?
Correct. It all depends on if the town wished to create a local district, what requirements they may place on that district, which would then go kind of above and beyond what the ordinance requires.
But it does restrict what the landowner or building owner could do with their building, and that also has to do with demolition. I just want to be real clear with this, that I understand what we're doing.
Yes,
and I recognize that we're not doing that tonight.
Right.
I understand that. I just, this is the first step, and I want to be sure that...
It could. It all depends on how the board wished to assign requirements within that district.
Well, as I read this contract, it says commission shall take no action under this section except prevent construction, reconstruction, alteration, restoration, moving or demolition of building structures, the pertinent structures, and it just keeps rolling on. So they can't really do anything to their building without a certificate of appropriateness.
That's correct.
Okay. All right. And the only interior that they can do is in public-owned buildings. They can't do interior on private-owned buildings.
That's my
just exterior.
Yes.
Okay. Demolition falls under pretty much the same thing, and you can't do demolition by neglect either. How do you think that would have, if it had been a historic district, it would have affected the old barbershop downtown?
It could have limited the process as far as how it was dealt with along the nuisance, but there again, not knowing what requirements may have been in place at that time.
Well, I'm just interested in your take on it. I mean, it does go on when it says that. It says, you know, safeguards to protect the property owner from undue economic hardship, and I think that one might have qualified for that. But I was just curious if you had given that any thought.
I hadn't.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. That's all I have. I just wanted some clarification to be sure where we were and what we were doing. And again, what we're doing is not adopting any district or landmark. We're simply joining with Wake County, assuming this board approves this tonight, to begin the process, and that it may come up at some later point.
That's correct.
Okay. Questions?
Yep. Clarification, Mark, if we can. You made reference to a district being possibly conceived of downtown, but you also made reference to all of them don't have to join in or be a participant in that. Did I understand that incorrectly? The way I read this thing is when you designate a district, that means the whole area.
The survey is just detailing some of the historic properties or sites within our jurisdiction, but it doesn't create a local district, which would have certain enforcement mechanisms associated with it. So the survey is just designating the properties that may be included within that, and I think it's more or less updating the 92 survey or the survey that led up to the 92 interlocal.
You're saying that's you can't cherry pick in there, though, or can you?
You're talking about the survey itself.
Let's talk about a downtown district, okay? Mm-hmm. Hypothetically, we've got one right now. All right, three of the businesses downtown don't want it.
They're not included in a they're just included in a survey of the historic properties, so it wouldn't be it wouldn't create any additional restrictions or regulations for their property just being in the survey.
And for clarification, though, they would not be, if we did a local district, which is kind of a far reach, but if we did, they could not be forced to be in that district.
That's correct. I mean, it would have to be up to this board to allow that. I did get clarification from Gary at Capital Area Preservation, and he said if there were some property owners that that were included in a local district designation, they would make a recommendation not to include those or pull them out before it even came before you.
Right.
But that's only if it was for a local district.
And that was my understanding, and a federal district doesn't carry any of those burdens at all.
That's correct. Only if you're going for the tax deferrals.
Okay.
Which is, you know, property owner's request.
Okay. I understand. I'm not against this, but I'm going to pose this situation to you anyway. You've got a district downtown. We have a program in the town of Zebulon now where merchants can borrow money from the town. to improve their property. Now, they're going to have, if they do that, they're going to have to follow the district rules, regulations before they can do anything.
Only if there's a local district designated. If they're included in the survey, it wouldn't have any requirements for them to make certain improvements. So it wouldn't, there wouldn't be any requirements at this time.
Okay.
Only if federal money, I think, is involved, would it then come into play.
Wait a minute, say that again now.
Only if, say, a bank is looking at locating downtown and making
federal
certain
money.
Improvements.
Okay, I understand. That's all I got.
Other questions for anyone? Everybody clear as mud?
Mm-hmm.
All right, what's your pleasure?
I make a motion we adopt the Historic Preservation Interlocal Agreement.
Second.
Motion made, second. Any other comments or discussion? All in favor? Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Board comments. Glenn, start with you tonight. Nothing? Dale? No?
No comment.
Nope. Everybody's quiet tonight. Joe?
I have some public service announcements. This Friday is movie night. Community Center starts at 7, free popcorn for those who attend. At the end of the month, on Friday, March 31st, from 4 to 6 at the Community Center, is going to be pictures with the Easter Bunny. And then the following day, and I can vouch for this because I've seen it. I was just told about it last year. But it happens quick, the Easter egg hunt on the front lawn at Town Hall on Saturday, April 1st at 10 o'clock. A little bit more substantive information. On November, there was a transit referendum that dedicated a revenue stream for transit services in Wake County as part of the rollout of that work plan and an opportunity for citizens to provide input into the transit work plan. There was going to be an input session at the Eastern Regional Center on Wednesday, March 29th from 4:30 to 7. And so they're looking for input on the transit work plan associated with the referendum. And if I could recognize Bobby Fitz for some budget transfers.
I'll be extremely brief. As required by the budget ordinance, these are some transfers that were made and have to be reported at next meeting. These are between operating items, below $5,000. And finance moved $1,000 from insurance and bonds to contracted services taxes. And buildings and grounds moved $500 from fuel expense to cell phones. And fire moved $5,000 from salaries to part-time salaries. And streets moved $800 from contract services to snow and ice materials, and moved $200 from contract service to miscellaneous. And sanitation moved $5,000 to contract services solid waste, $4,000 of that from salaries, $500 from group insurance, $500 from retirement, and stormwater moved $150 from miscellaneous to insurance and bonds. Brief, as I said.
Thanks, sir. You have anything else, Jeff?
No, sir.
All right. Is there a motion to adjourn? In a second? We're adjourned.
Stick me for telling it.